they are bound, and of course they will be judged if they hear, refuse to believe, and refuse to obey the gospel. So here Peter is preaching, if you were to read the preceding verses and the subsequent verses to those verses that we have read in the interim here, you would see that he is speaking to those individuals of Cornelius' household, which were all Gentiles. And he says in verse 42, and he commanded us to preach unto the people and to testify that it is he which was ordained of God to be the judge of quick and dead. Now the term quick is a classic example of how languages and words change through the process of time and their meaning. In that day, better than, I guess we should say 300 years ago, back in 1611, when the King James Version was translated into the English language, you may remember that this term did not have anything to do with speed. When we speak of quick today, it has to do with speed, swiftness, and it would be a verb. But back in that day, this particular term has to do with another meaning, which means the living and the dead. He, that is Jesus Christ, is ordained to be the judge of the living and the dead. And he will judge those of us that are living today, and he will judge those that are dead and will live when they get up and stand before God at the white throne of judgment. In one place, the scripture says, whether we live unto the Lord. Whether we die unto the Lord. Therefore, whether we live or die, we are the Lord's. And no one, and I do mean no one, will escape the judgment of God. All of us will be judged whether we desire to be judged or not. And so this is what we will get into tonight in the scriptures to show emphatically to everyone here that Jesus is and will be the judge of the quick and the dead, or the living and the dead. Now we today are currently being judged, because Peter said, I believe it's in the book of 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 16, for the time has come. Now is the judgment must begin at the house of God. And if it first begin at us, then where shall the sinner and the ungodly appear? And if the righteous scarcely be saved? Praise the Lord. And so this is what we have to recognize tonight, is that once we are born again of water and spirit, we come under the royal law of the church. This is what the scripture calls it, the royal law of the church, and we are constantly under the judgment of God. Now sometimes people backslide and go back into the world, and they think that when they go backslide and go back into the world, they are out from underneath the auspices of the royal law of the church. But you must understand, once you come into the church, you never get from underneath the law of God or the royal law of God that you come under when you come into the church. And you may backslide, but God will still use the royal law of the church to judge you by, because you have the opportunity to walk with God and be successful, but you chose not to do so. Now, one of our district elders on the East Coast was teaching this false doctrine that when people leave the church, they no longer are under the law of God or the royal law of the church. And so whether they leave the church and go back out there and tear up their marriages and split up with their wives and husbands and then come back in the church, then they can come back in and start all over again. But let me just let you know, it doesn't work like that. And that is nothing but deception, because once you come under the royal law of the church, you are under it for as long as you live. And God will judge us all by it. And he is the judge of the quick, or the living and the dead. Also, we should understand now, we are constantly sitting, now that we're in the church, before the judgment seat of Christ. And the scripture says, I believe it's the Apostle Paul that said in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, that if we would judge ourselves, then we would not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we will not be condemned with the world. And so we are under the judgment of God today, and we can continue to submit ourselves to the judgment of God as it is taught and executed through the teaching of God's word and the ministry that he has set in the New Testament church, or we can refuse to get ourselves straightened out in this day and do what the scripture says to do, and then we will have to face God at the great white throne of judgment. And I believe it is in the book of 2 Timothy where he said, some men's sins are open beforehand, going before them into judgment, but some men's sins follow after. One preacher put it like this: I'd rather know the worst of my condition now, when I can do something about it, than to find out about it later when it's too late to do anything about it. And so this is why we constantly come to Bible class and sit in these particular environs, so that we can be judged by the word of God. And we are constantly being washed with water by the word. He is bringing to our attention things that we need to begin to do that we are failing to do, and things we need to cease doing we have no right to do. Or they're called sins of omission and sins of commission. And so tonight, let us have an understanding that we are before the judgment seat of Christ. Let us go to 2 Corinthians now and establish that fact. Praise the Lord. And chapter 5 in 2 Corinthians, verse number 10. Now, this has been a very misconstrued scripture. I guess since we're in this chapter, we had better go back to verse number 5. We better begin with verse number 5. Well, let's start with verse number 6, and we'll read down to verse number 10. Because I want to show you something here. You have these at these funerals who are quoting the scripture, and they are tearing it up. And there, may I tell you, you don't have to leave the PAW to hear it. For our brother putting people in heaven before anyone has gone there. Now, if you go to heaven when you die, then what good is a resurrection of the dead? What need is there for a rapture? But the Bible says in 2 Thessalonians 4:13 that this we say by the word of the Lord, that the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel and the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall already be in heaven. Well, I intentionally misread that, because this is what our brethren are doing. They're putting them in heaven already. It said the dead in Christ shall rise first, and we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them. So if they were already going there, they died, there would be no need for them to rise. And it is a gross contradiction on our brother's part. And they take this scripture, tear it up, and use this to try to state that these individuals are already gone into what they call paradise. Now, no one's going to paradise, because paradise is not a place. It is a condition. It simply means the best state that you can attain based on the life that you have lived. And when he said to the man on the cross, the thief on the cross, today shalt thou be with me in paradise. This means that Jesus was imputing to him righteousness, and he will get up in the second resurrection and be caught up in the second resurrection, stand before God, be counted righteous, and placed on the new earth. He couldn't get anything more than that in the order, because he had not been born again of water and spirit. So yes, he had salvation, but he didn't go anywhere. He died on the cross next to Jesus and went in the grave, and he had salvation imputed unto him. But this is an imagination that our brethren have come up with that they cannot back with the scriptures. And anything we cannot back with the scriptures, we need to leave it alone. Or just let people know, well, this is what I think. This is what I feel. And then if that's what you want to feel and that's what you want to think, that's your business. But don't try to make it seem like that's what the Word of God says. Can we say amen? Amen. So anyway, verse number 6, let's read. Therefore, we are always confident, Paul said, knowing that while we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord, for we walk by faith, not by sight. Simply means as long as we are living in this life in the days of the flesh, we are not in heaven yet with him. It does not mean that we're backslidden or the Lord is not with us, but we have not yet taken on our bodies, which are from heaven, that he speaks of in verses 1 and 2. Because we still have these bodies that are earthly bodies, therefore we do not have our what? Heavenly bodies. Read. We are confident, I say, and willing rather, to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. It didn't say that we were. He said we are confident, Brother Moore. This is what we are confident and would rather be. If we have our choice, we would rather be in heaven than on earth. Now, where did someone get that he said, when you die, you go straight to heaven? This is not even dealing with you dying and going to heaven. But Paul is saying that we are confident, and we would, if we have our choice, we would rather, or we are willing rather, to be absent from the body. We'd rather put off these bodies and put on our bodies, which are from where? From heaven, if we have our choice. For if you read the first two verses, you would notice that he's talking about putting off these bodies, earthly bodies, and putting on our what? Heavenly bodies. Praise the Lord. Verse number 9, read. Verse 9? Let's read. Wherefore, we labor that whether present or absent, we may be accepted of him. Whether he comes and gives us our new bodies and we are with him present in heaven, or whether we are, or should I say, whether we're present living in our natural bodies in this life, or whether we are present with him with our new bodies in heaven, we labor, therefore, that whether present with him or absent, not yet being in heaven, we may be what? Accepted with him. But where did this say to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord? No, somebody came up with that. And it sounded good. And they quoted it. And somebody else heard it. And it sounded good. And so they quoted it. And you know how that is. What now people are quoting is not a 30-second cousin to what's in the Bible. So I am not saying this is a salvation issue. If people want to believe that, that's not going to keep them out of heaven. But we should not be using psychology to make people think the scripture says one thing when it didn't say that at all. We're just laboring, whether we are living in this body here on earth or whether we are receive our bodies, which are from heaven and are present with him, we're laboring that we might be what? Accepted. We want him to accept us and not reject us. We want to be saved. Praise the Lord. Well, I guess if I teach in the council, I have to teach this and start an uproar in the PAW. But you know, I don't have any problem with that. But this is what people are saying. Now verse number 10, let's read. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body, according to that he have done, whether it be good or bad. May I tell you that we are before the judgment seat of Christ now, and we will stand before the great white throne of what? Judgment. And what this simply means is that all of us have to own up to the conduct that we, or the way that we conduct ourselves and the lives that we live in these bodies now that we are what? Saved. And so the judgment of God is going on now in our life, and it will culminate. Now, if we make the rapture, we don't have to worry about at the judgment seat of Christ or at the great white throne of judgment whether or not we have made it or not. because of the great, great white throne of judgment. Our judgment will not be whether or not we have made it. It will be what rewards we receive. And that's what we're going to talk about tonight, the rewards that we are to be given during the millennial reign and at the great white throne of what? Judgment. But the rest of those who didn't get up in the first resurrection that we, that will be in the first resurrection, got up in, their judgment at the great white throne of judgment will be as to whether or not they made it or not, whether or not they are counted righteous in the sight of God or not. Praise the Lord. And so it's far better for us to make it now than to fool around and have to be judged later. Can we say amen? Amen. Now then, let us go to the gospel according to St. Matthew. And we want to reiterate to you that this is the close of the tribulation period. We read this on Tuesday night, did we not? Chapter number 24. And if you weren't here Tuesday, you can get the tape. But St. Matthew chapter 24, verses 29 through 31 is what we want. And I want to emphasize something to you, but we need to reread these verses that we have read on verse 29 that we read on Tuesday night. Can we say amen? All right, let's start with verse 29. Now, I'm not going to reiterate to you what I reiterated to you on Tuesday, which was simply that the apostles asked Jesus three questions, and they're found in verse number 3. And he is answering here the second and third question. Praise the Lord. Now, so you can read that in your spare time, get the tape from Tuesday, and then you will be able to follow what we were talking about Tuesday concerning the three questions the apostles asked him and the three questions that he answered that they asked him. Can we say amen? All right, verse number 29. Immediately after the tribulation of those days, so the sun be darkened, and the moon shall not give her light, and the stars shall fall from heaven, and the powers of the heavens shall be shaken. Now you may remember, as we indicated to you on Tuesday, this particular phenomenon occurs in the sixth seal, when Jesus breaks the sixth seal in the sixth chapter of the book of Revelation. For this is when the sun is darkened, and the moon gives not her light, and the stars fall from heaven, and the clouds in heaven roll back like a scroll, it speaks of in the book of Revelation, and they look up and see Jesus coming in his righteousness and power, and the saints coming with him, and they run to the hills and to the mountains and say, fall on us, hide us from the wrath of him that is to come. And so now this is in the sixth seal, which is the beginning of the last half of the tribulation period, which should let you know from the expression in immediately after the tribulation of those days, that expression should let you know that there has been tribulation going on and there is some tribulation to follow. And so now in verse number 30, let's read, and then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven. And in the graphic detail of this, as I just mentioned to you, is in the sixth chapter of the book of Revelation, when the heavens roll back like a scroll and they look up and see Jesus coming. This is what Jesus has reference to here in Matthew, which can be found also in the book of what? Revelation. And of course, if you get the tapes, you'll be able to follow along very strategically. Let's read. And then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn. Yes, they will cry out and run to the mountains and hills and say, fall on us and hide us from the wrath of him that is to come. Because at this point, everyone that is going to be saved in the tribulation period will be saved and will have been caught up to God and be standing before him and the glorified church on the sea of glass, according to the book of Revelation. So they will begin to mourn, because remember now, at this point, this is the last half of the tribulation period. And remember now, there are seven trumpets that are to be blown. and the carnage that is going to follow those seven trumpets, then is followed by seven plagues or seven last vials that the angels pour out upon this earth. And the last half of the tribulation period is so much worse than the first half of the tribulation period that there is almost no comparison whatsoever. And so now, we're not dealing so much with the tribulation period as we're moving now into the last details of the millennial reign that we've been teaching on. But we do have to continue to revisit some of those things so that you can follow along as we show you what will be taking place. So now, the earth shall mourn, read, and they shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power. Well, isn't that what I just told you? Why didn't you believe me? Of course, some of you did, didn't you? So that's wonderful too. Can we say amen? Amen? They will look up and see him as we spoke of earlier. Verse number 31, read. And he shall send his angels with a great sound of a trumpet. They shall gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other. Now there are those that have a misconception of the scripture that will tell you this is the rapture of the church, and they will tell you, see, the church is going through the tribulation period, and then after the tribulation period, after the end of the first half of the tribulation period and in the middle of the tribulation period, you see, then God's going to gather together the church. But I want you to understand something you just read here. This is not the church. The church is not going through the tribulation period, and I hope you understand what you just read. This is not the gathering of God's people in the church from one end of earth to the other. This is the gathering together of his elect from one end of heaven to the other. So we will not be on earth. We will be in heaven. And we will be in heaven for 7 years, feasting our eyes on the handiwork of God. And he will send his angels to gather us together to come back from the four ends of the heaven to fight the battle of Armageddon and to reign with him during the millennial reign. So don't allow anyone to take the scriptures and deceive you. Praise the Lord. And so now, this is why we read this, so that you could see that this is our gathering from the four winds, from one end of heaven, what? To the other. This is us being gathered. Oh yes, and we will be just traveling through the universe, looking at the creation of God. And we will not need any spacesuits. Now, when they go up now in the space shuttle, and you remember they went up in the Apollo 1 and the Apollo 2. Praise the Lord. And I don't remember all of the astronauts' names, but they went up and they catapulted through their scientific genius, through the ionosphere and the stratosphere and the magnetic field, and went out into outer space, and eventually they did get to the moon. And how did they survive? Well, you see, none of the planets in our galaxy and other galaxy are habitable, because the only planet that God made that is able to be inhabited is the Earth. And they have sent multitudes of satellites and multitudes of space equipment out there to travel through our Milky Way and to study Mars and Venus, Pluto, Uranus, Jupiter and Saturn, and the other planets in our orbit. And they have found that there is absolutely no life nor any means of sustaining life in these and on these planets. So how did these men go up there? Well, they went up there, all right, but they took the elements from Earth, harnessed them in space equipment, and then they took those elements from this Earth out there and preserved it for tenure that they were in outer space. And if they had run out of oxygen that they had harnessed from this earth, you know what? They would be dead. If they had run out of water, they would have died. If they had run out of food, they would have died. Because there is no way to sustain life out there at this point. Now, there is a point in God's creation that he will make those planets habitable. And we will get to that in the scriptures. But we want you to understand at this point that when we make the rapture, we will be able to travel out there without spacesuits. I won't have to wait for the shuttle to blast off, because we will be like him, for we will see him as he is. Praise the Lord. Now, don't you want to be there? You better be there. That's what you're saved for, to be there. Can the church say amen? Now then, we will be with him, but now this is him gathering us together to come back, put an end to man's government, and to reign with him. So now let us go now to the book of the second epistle of John. Praise the Lord. The second epistle of John, that's right before the book of Revelation, or right before the book of Jude, which is right before the book of Revelation. The second epistle of the second letter of John, and it doesn't make any difference whether you get the first or the last chapter, because there's only one. All right, then in verse number 8, we want one verse of scripture, and let us take that scripture now and read. If you have it, can you say amen? Amen. Let's read. Look to yourselves that we lose not those things which we have wrought, but that we receive a full reward. Did you not know that you can lose your reward after you have accumulated a great deal that God has ordained to give you? Now, someone said, how can you lose your reward? You can, as one of our ministers, great preacher, done a great deal of preaching and teaching, bringing souls to Christ. You can backslide after walking with God for 20 years, 20 years of service to God, 20 years of service that God is going to reward you for. You backslide and go back on God into the world. And after you get out there, and you're out there for a short space of time, you come to yourself and realize that you need to be back in the house of God. God grants you repentance. You come back to the house of God. You are rebaptized, refreshed. You make your confession, manifest the seven fruits of repentance found in 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verses 10 and 11. You are fully restored, but you have lost all of the years of service and have to start all over again. Now, how do we know that? I want you to look at something. 15th chapter of the Gospel according to St. Luke. Let's go there now. I want to show it to you. St. Luke chapter 15. Praise the Lord. All right. Let's start with verse number 11. We're going to read down to verse number 14. Let's read. Now, this is the parable. This is called the parable of who? The prodigal son. Let's read.